This episode of Standard Orbit is brought to you by Audible.com, offering more than 180,000 titles for smartphone, tablet, and desktop. To get a free audiobook of your choice and help Trek FM at the same time, visit audibletrial.com/trekfm. And also by Enterprise in Space, an international program for the nonprofit National Space Society. Find out how you can help science and education and become a virtual crew member aboard the NSS Enterprise Orbiter by visiting enterpriseinspace.org. Want to join the conversation and share your thoughts on this episode? Join the Babel Conference, our listeners group on Facebook. Just type B-A-B-E-L into the Facebook search field. We look forward to seeing you there.
This is Walter Koenig, Chekhov from Star Trek, and you're listening to Trek FM.
Risk is our business.
It's like nothing we've dealt with before.
By golly, Jim, I'm beginning to think I can cure a rainy day.
I can't change the laws of physics.
Now in standard orbit, sir.
Welcome, everyone, to Standard Orbit, Trek FM's dedicated podcast that covers the original and new cast of Captain Kirk and the Enterprise. I am Ken Tripp.
And I am Zach Moore. And what do we love talking about here, Ken, on Standard Orbit? We love talking about lost episodes of the original series. Our episode 205, The Lost Episodes. See how I did that?
Some nice. You even got the number, brother. I love it.
It's within five, but... anyway, that turned out to be a very fun, very popular episode that we had done, and we're back because fortunately or unfortunately, depending on how you look at it, there are a lot of episodes of the original series that were planned that never came to be. So we're going to talk about some more today, aren't we, Ken?
We are, and I'm looking forward to it. I, when we did it the first time, reading the outlines for the first go around, I thought was very intriguing to me. And of course, you know, it gets all that energy going because you think of, with Discovery being back on and the JJ verse still out there, or the Kelvin timeline or whatever you want to call it, still out there. There's so many episodes, so many movies or whatever, and people just keep coming up with new and creative ideas. And I think, you know, the fact that we're looking at episodes that were written 50 years ago or more, or outlines of interviews, episodes that were written 50 years ago or more, some great concepts. And a lot of these things would still apply. And you can see where, you know, some of these things have been kind of bits and pieces have been taking from these concepts into episodes that we saw in TNG. So to me, it's a lot of fun to look through these, Zach. You did a great job finding these.
Yeah, so today, you know, in TOS fashion, we're going to do things in threes. I think I broke down why we do it that way last episode. Also, you know, it gives us nice, concise conversation. We're not, you know, we don't want to bite off more than we can chew. We could sit here for like 3 hours and talk about all these if we wanted, but we're kind of breaking it up, divvying it out, you know, spreading it out throughout our schedule this year. So we're going to talk about three more episodes, episodes written by David Gerald, Gene Kuhn, Normal Spinrad, and John Meredith Lucas. So these are big TOS names. These aren't just nobody, you know, submit, because, you know, once we get through a lot of these, I think we're going to start finding this random author who submitted this one outline that nobody liked or something like that. But we're still in the kind of legit original series writers at this point.
Right, right. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to diving in, talking it through, and then hearing what folks have to say on the Babel Conference once we get through it. And, of course, obviously, we'll be discussing some of the similarities that did get pulled from these concepts and talk a little bit on how well they executed it.
So, Ken, you want to start us off with our first episode and tell us what it's all about?
Yeah, this is interesting. This one was called Bandy. Does that sound familiar?
Yes. I think they pulled that out. They pulled a George Lucas. They put that on the shelf and they dusted it off. Years later, they didn't use it, right?
Well, that's right. I always think of the folks in the very first episode of TNG, right? Weren't they Bandy?
Yeah, the old Bandy City.
The old Bandy City, yeah. So anyway, so Gerald wrote this this story that he came up with this idea of Kirk temporarily taking command of another starship to investigate reports that the crew had gone lax, right? And that, you know, did it need to be tightened up a little bit? Again, another concept I think we can talk about. It's set aboard the Enterprise, and Kirk discovers that there's a mascot that was smuggled aboard by a crew member named Bandy, and it has an empathic ability to cause sympathy for it. So Kirk, being Kirk, right, wants it confined so people can really kind of understand what it is. But it always gets out because of, you know, empathy towards a crew member nearby. And when one of the one of our dear red shirts dies, I assume, because of a distraction caused by the animal, Kirk wants it off the ship. And then Bandy turns against Kirk. But Spock kills it.
As he does.
kind of dramatic, right? The crew snaps out of kind of their lax behavior. And... it's interesting, right? Because the behavior of the crew led Gerald to believe that Kirk temporarily commanding another ship where the problem really happens. It's just a very interesting outline, and I thought that he'd play with it a little more. But we do know, like I said before, we do see the term again in a counter at far point. So Zach,
I do like, yeah, what he said though. He said if that line had sold, if it had gone to actual episode production, he would have come up with a better name than Bandy, which ironically he reused it because he was big time in early TNG, you know, conceiving the show. If you guys have seen the Blu-ray sets, you know, he's up there. He's in there with Robert Justin, DC Fontana, when Gene Roddenberry brought all these guys back from the original series.
Right.
He had a big hand in early TNG, and he's right there reusing it in the pilot, in the counter five point for those aliens. So it's interesting that he's like, yeah, I'm going to come up with a better name, but it's good enough for me to use in the 80s. So
yeah, you know, it's funny. Gerald's an interesting character in and of itself. Obviously, Trouble with Tribbles is what put him on the map. And he's written quite a few things since, you know, here and there for different TV shows and so forth. He was obviously a big part of the first, I guess, 2 years of TNG, and he talks about it in Chaos on the Bridge, and it's mentioned quite a bit as well in Nemechek's book, the TNG Companion. So I find that he's very opinionated, very very strong on things. He's almost like one of those creative types that you can see has all these things flowing in his head, and he can get very aggressive or defensive depending on what the subject is. He's a very interesting guy, but he's obviously an icon when it comes to Star Trek for coming up with I wouldn't say it's, you know, one of the top episodes, but probably one of the more, if not the most popular Star Trek episode in history. Everybody knows now what a tribble is, right? And that critter has found itself throughout all the different incarnations of Star Trek. But this concept, I think it's a great concept. I really do. I think now, though, because of Discovery, and we think of like the tardigrade and things, we just, Spock kills it. I mean, it's very direct, right? You're just like, well,
it must be Mirror Spock, and it must be the twist at the end, right?
Not send it back to its home or where it belongs or anything along that line.
It's interesting, we joke about that, and that's what the common, again, that's what we do here in Center. We kind of peel back these stereotypes of TOS, right? I think in early TOS, if you look at the Man Trap, the very first episode, they kill the monster and they move on, right? And that was typical sci-fi. But then as Star Trek continued, I think the next best example of that is Devil in the Dark, which is 180 degrees on the other side, where like, no, you need to understand this creature, even though it's not like us, doesn't mean it's evil, et cetera, et cetera.
Right.
And that's kind of the Star Trek message that set it apart from like Lost in Space or whatever, right? Where they'd like, oh, it's a monster, we got to kill it.
Right.
I would understand if this was like, you know, before the show had come out, but this is like, you know, this is in the second season, so you would think that they would have more established the difference here, between a normal sci-fi show, a generic sci-fi show might find a monster and kill it, but we on Star Trek, we try to understand it and communicate with it and et cetera, et cetera. So it's interesting they went to, like, you guys are just laughing about Spock kills it. it's like, oh, okay, because that's what Spock does. Because even like, even in episodes like Cat's Paw, right? Like at the end, like the aliens are kind of dying, and Spock's like, "Oh, if we could, you know, study them for further use." You know, he doesn't want to see him die because he's a scientist first. You know,
right?
So yeah, he's going to be the first guy to advocate for studying new life forms. But as far as this goes, I guess David Gerald has a thing for like creatures and stuff. Because if you look at Trouble Tribbles, you know, he does a BIM. Which, one day on this sub series here, we'll talk about that, because that was actually an animated series episode planned for TOS. You know, so it's got a creature that can like disassemble and reassemble, and the special effects budget was a big reason that didn't come to pass. And this is another one, and I just try to think like how they would have translated this idea. I think of like a little person like in a costume is what I think of. You know, because obviously you can't use like an immobile prop or anything like a tribble. That's like the easiest prop ever, right? You get sound effects and furry balls, right? But this, I'm thinking like a, you know, kind of like a, I think this, and I think about Kiesner from the Kelvin timeline. That's kind of where my mind goes when I think about Bandy. Do you have an image of what Bandy might look like in your head when you read this episode?
I guess I do. It's funny. It's like a cross between like the Daggett from the original Battlestar Galactica, you know, the little mechanical dog.
Oh, the dog. Okay. Yeah. I know what you're talking about. Yeah.
Yeah. It just, you know, it had the big eyes. It was very empathetic, you know, and I know there was a monkey that was inside the Daggett costume. You know, I don't know how the ASPCA would do with that today, but anyway, it's just one of those that's what I don't know why I just kind of picture a creature with big, very empathetic eyes, creating mayhem, you know, that type of thing. So I don't know. And we also know, right, this is the layout, this is the concept. Once it goes through 15 different writers' hands and Gene goes through it or whatever, I'm sure.
So I was going to say, once Gene Reimer gets a hold of it, it's going to be something totally different. So.
Oh, yeah. Or, you know, at least just enough so he can get his name on it, right? So it was just one of those things where, but, you know, as an outline, you know, there's a lot to work with here.
Yeah, I think so. Whenever you bring on, and it's a bottle show, it sounds like, right? So I'm sure that put it to the top of the pile. Oh, good, we don't have to go anywhere or do any location shooting for this. So this would be prime episode 3, season 3 material.
But I do like the concept though of Kirk going to another starship, because I feel like it's lax, right? And you've got that approach, I think, is unique. All Star Trek fans love it when they show another starship. So he goes over there, finds this thing, and pulls it over to the Enterprise, which I thought was fascinating in and of itself.
That's interesting. As a captain, he'd be doing that. Like, if he was a Commodore or an Admiral, like, you know, we see in Star Trek 2, he's doing an inspection or something. I could see that. It was where I think maybe that was more justifying why the crew would get, like, turned against Kirk, because people have a problem with that. I mean, see Star Trek 5, right? People have a problem with that. So they're like, okay, If the Enterprise crew doesn't turn against him, maybe we put him on another ship. That makes explanation. So I feel like that was a kind of a reaction to criticism that necessarily can part of the story. But all that to say, I'm the first one who always says, oh, it's great to see another ship. Even though the sets are exactly the same and the models are exactly the same, we get to see another patch on the uniform, right, Ken?
I guess we do,
starship. Because that's canon, because it's on screen, guys. Say, all I hear about is cannons on screen, what's not on screen, and I hear, oh, no, that's a mistake. On all those times we saw those patches, those are mistakes. Anyway, we love poking fun at that kind of stuff. But this story actually did come to light in Star Trek the manga, which I was unfamiliar with. I assume you were unfamiliar with as well, Ken.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I haven't heard of the manga.
So this is something that came out in the 2000s, actually. It was a Tokyo Pop. Came out with it. It was a series of anthologies. It had 3 volumes from 06 to 08. Mm-hmm. And David Gerald adapted the story for that format in the 3rd volume of that. So this is, I had no idea. I'm a graphic novel guy, and I enjoy comic books and whatnot, but I'm not really into manga. So I was 100% unfamiliar with this. So it's interesting. We were talking about in our last episode on these last episodes, the Droid Machine. You know, so it's interesting when there's a story concept that doesn't make it to the screen that gets adapted in another medium. So I think that's cool that even though we didn't see the story in live action, it did find its way into a manga. So it can be appreciated and kind of assimilated that way. So if anyone's actually read Star Trek the manga, let us know in the comments. I assume more people would have read the Droid Machine novel than would have read the Star Trek manga, because I mean that's one of those things that even I didn't know exist. And I know I know pretty much most of the Star Trek stuff that exists. So, but hey, some of y'all out there have a believe it or not, I will admit it, some of y'all have a greater Star Trek knowledge than myself. So if y'all have read the manga, please let us know and let us know what you thought of the story and how they translated it over there.
With our listeners, slam dunk, man. They'll be There'll be a bunch that'll be able to talk to it. There's no doubt. And I love it, too, because they always like, yeah, this is what they did with it. And you go, oh, okay. So it's pretty cool. Are we ready for the next one there, Zach?
Yeah, so the next one is He Walked Among Us. This was a script by Gene L. Kuhn and Norman Spinrad of Doomsday Machine fame. Mm. And it was submitted in the second season. And the producers actually approached Spinrad with the task to write an episode to be a vehicle for Milton Berle, who expressed an interest in appearing on Star Trek. Are you familiar with this actor? Do you know who this is, Ken?
Milton Berle, not Berle.
See, there you go. Pronunciation.
Pronunciation. So Milton Berle was probably the he had Uncle Milty, right? Was a famous show in the 50s, live show, and many writers worked on that became very Mel Brooks was one of the key ones. Sid Caesar, who did Show of Shows, worked very closely with Milton Berle.
Okay, I know who both of those are. Okay.
Yep. And so, and if you saw a picture of Milton Berle, you'd know exactly who he is. I mean, he's been around forever. You know, had a trademark cigar, tall guy, very, very famous. And, you know, he was, I'm using this term a lot lately, but he was iconic, and especially right up through the mid-80s, right? He lived a long life, but he was a very, very famous comedian and a big presence, you know, for those 25, 30 years that he was, you know, in front of the spotlight.
Cool. Well, yeah, and it's always cool to know people that wanted to be on Star Trek. You know, it's like it's one of those shows that, like, the Twilight Zone or Batman, right? But people, big stars, they wanted to be part of it. So that's cool that he expressed an interest.
It was like Eddie Murphy's popularity, right, in 1986 when they were talking about putting him in Star Trek IV. It was similar. You know, big time comedian would have a lot of name recognition and would pull a lot of people in. There's no doubt about it.
You see, and I'm glad Eddie Murphy did not make it into Star Trek 4, because as we saw in the Superman movies, Richard Pryor made it into Superman 3, and we all know what happened there. But anyway, moving on. Let's stay on topic. They also told something else that the producers told Spinrad was there was a village set available, like a tribal village, and told him to write the story in which it could be used. So I know we're always joking around about, season 2 was the season of the alternate Earth, right? Like, okay, mm-hmm. We got a Nazi planet, we got a Roman planet. Basically, like, they're going through the back lot, they're going through the prop department, the costume department. Like, what do we got? So this is literally that in action right here. But the original story by Spinrad was about a primitive race called the Jugali, which I guess they thought, oh, it's a jungle tribe, so let's call them the Jugali. But they inexplicably employed technology well beyond their capacity. And as a result of interference by a Federation sociologist who only wanted to do good, but it eventually resulted in terrible consequences. So speaking of the quote-unquote Nazi episode, that does sound familiar, because mm-hmm. that's exactly what happens in that episode. Kirk is faced with this person, you know, breaking the Prime Directive and kind of like Omega Glory, right? He's like, okay, well, this is a big deal, you know? I mean, it's for all the people that say Kirk's his rule breaker, like when he encounters other Federation people breaking the rules, he gets really offended by it, because this is a code that they live by. But the crux here is, like, you know, the society is so tightly woven itself to what the sociologist has set up. He set himself up as, like, you know, the absolute ruler, the a god figure, a fewer, right, as happens in Patterns of Force. That it's like, well, how do I remove this guy, because what he did was wrong, but then not have the society fall apart. So I think that's interesting, and I do feel like this did become Patterns of Force in a way. I think this might have been better, because the whole Nazi imagery makes a lot of people uncomfortable, and it does also it's like the most ridiculous idea ever. It's like, well, you know, Nazi Germany worked, but if we just take the hate out, you know, we might be able to. It's like, ugh, the trains ran on time. It's like, what a terrible sociologist. You're a Federation sociologist, man. What are you doing? But anyway, I do find it interesting that that we have a Federation sociologist that's in the classic TOS vein of, here's our meteorologist and here's our historian and here's, you know, just the random job of the week, which I want to have an episode on sometime. Ken, we need to make, I'll make a list of all these random jobs and we could talk about them, because it's always like, sir. Fill in the blank specialists will be beaming down with us, and of course they're a big, you know, part of the story. But anyway, all that to say, that's He Walked Among Us. Last thing I'll say about this, so we can get into it. New Voyages was actually going to make this into a fan film a few years ago, but CBS asked them not to for whatever reason. And people are like, oh, no, is that going to be the plot of the one of the new Star Trek movies? Like, no, I don't think so, guys. I think they might have just, that was the early days of them flexing their copyright muscle back in the day. So anyway, that's He Walked Among Us. What are your thoughts, Ken?
It is so disjointed that I can see why it got away from them. If you look at the original...
Got away from me talking about it.
Sure did. But, you know, first of all, if you look at the original kind of concept, it's not... It's somewhat original, but we've seen it before, right? An outside influence has an impact and, you know, violates the Prime Directive, you know, because you have a sociologist who just wants to do good, but, you know, there's all these terrible consequences that come across. We've seen that. The difference here is they specifically say, you know, the person is a Federation health food nut who takes over the planet. Well, what does that have to do with anything, right? And then, you know, and then sets himself up as a god. So they had a nice little tight little concept that could have been, you know, really, I guess, flushed out a lot more, and it could have been a very interesting story, because it happens all the time. It's a Star Trek trope, you know, that these things occur. And so, you know, what direction would it have taken? Hopefully not a health food nut taking over, you know, I mean, I don't know. What does he show up with, a TB12 method or something? And, you know,
that plant-based diet, man, it's an incredible thing.
That's right. Just eat avocado in this. But at any rate, there's a reason why sometimes when you step back, right, because I'm sure in our careers many times we start down a path and you start pulling in different elements, and before you know it, you've made it so complex or so disjointed, it just isn't going to fly. And usually it's somebody else who steps back, who can see it from a different point of view or maybe a higher level, and comes back and says, guys, you know, ladies, this is way out of control. And I think that's what happened here. They just came back and went, no, this is
horrible. It's interesting. And I'm glad you kind of cut through there, because even I was having trouble trying to summarize what this was all about. Gene Coon eventually stepped in and rewrote it as a comedy, because that was kind of his forte, you know, the height of season two, you know, the lightheartedness of Gene Coon infused into the show. Still didn't work. And then eventually Spinrad himself asked Roddenberry, and this is a direct quote, he said, quote, "Don't embarrass his show by shooting this piece of, well, fill in the blank, the colorful metaphor there," end quote. So anyway, the episode was not produced. They tried to resurrect it in the third season. Fred Freiberger, he had actually, good on Fred Freiberger. I know he gets a lot of flack, but, you know, season three, he looked at a lot of older scripts. So, you know, as we go through these episodes in this sub-series here, we'll see that, like, yes, this was pitched in season one or two, didn't work. Fred brought it back for season three, took another look at it, still didn't work, you know.
It would have been something, I think it would have become one of those legendary Spock brains type of episodes.
Well, you know, you could have got, you need to go that way, right? You want it to be absurdly ridiculous but entertaining, or like, oh, this is a really good episode, right? So that's, you know, it's hard to pick a lane. If you're lukewarm, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth, Star Trek episodes. So pick hot or cold, man. They could have gone, you know, they really, looking at this, taking a step back, and they could have gone all like Heart of Darkness with it, right? If they really wanted to, you know, they go find this guy, the Marlon Brando figure, right? You know, who set himself up in the society, and like, that'd be cool. But I don't know. Like, if they were rewrote it as a comedy, they clearly didn't think the drama angle would have worked with this episode. And again, you get interference. You're writing it for an actor who wants to be on. You got the studio telling you, look, these are the sets we need to use. Try to incorporate them. Like, you can see how all these factors ended up in this kind of jumbled mess that even the writer himself was like, yeah, don't make this. So,
yep. Time to pull the chute and jump, baby. Or maybe jump and pull the chute, one or the other. But that would have been funny, too, if they pulled the chute before they jumped. But anyway, I agree with you. This is this was funny to read. And it's also kind of cool to see that, you know, how difficult it is to come up with a concept, right, for an episode and then always hit a home run. And, you know, I think we see that all the time in the older shows that had to do 24 to 26 episodes a year. You're just going to have a few that don't execute, or it just doesn't come off right. Or maybe in some cases where they're just drained and they stick with something they probably know deep down inside isn't going to fly. Like I said, I don't think anybody intentionally puts out a bad episode. And it's interesting, too, because I think I hold the new Discovery series at a much higher level, because they're only doing 13 to 15 episodes a year. And to me, it's like, you're doing half of what other folks did. It better execute. It better be well thought out. The effects ought to be flawless. And, you know, so far, for the most part, that's worked out. I'm just, you know, it's just a different mindset. It's like, you don't have to be as creative as these other folks because you've just got 13 to do. And when you're trying to do as many as these guys and ladies were trying to do, it's hard. It is really hard. To the point where, you know, in today's world, you really don't see it unless they're like these really bad, and I mean really bad, half-hour comedy shows. You know, I can't think of one show that's on today that's even remotely funny.
Well, even in the hour-long dramas, right, on the broadcast TV, because cable, like, it's like, you know, Netflix, streaming service, Hulu, it's like 8, 10, maybe 13 episodes, right?
Right.
Discovery was supposed to be, I think, 10 or 13 originally. They added a couple more episodes on to make it 15.
Right.
You go to cable, it's usually around 15. But broadcast, right,
mm-hmm.
even those shows are like 22 episodes. That is 4 or 5 episodes less sometimes, because sometimes they're 21, 22 than what Star Trek was putting out. Like Next Gen, like every season is 26 except for season 2,
right,
which was shortened by a strike, which made it 22 episodes, which is the standard now for broadcast. But then you look back at TOS, they got like 30 episodes in like the first season. That's you look at, you know, shows like The Twilight Zone, right? They got like 30 episodes a season.
Right.
So it's crazy. Yeah, and that's the daily grind. And you get there, and that's why, you know, it's always fun to look at, oh, look, they did the same story again. Well, yeah, because they're like, well, I don't know, guys. I'm out of ideas. This worked a couple years ago. No, reruns weren't a thing. Home video wasn't a thing. You know, so like, okay, that was 1966. This is 1969. Nobody saw that episode. Do it again. So that's why you get a lot of repeats like that.
Yep, just a different approach. So like I said, to me, it's kind of fun seeing the concepts that they came up with, and somebody smart enough to go, no. But, you know, still in all, there was a lot of creative elements to that. It just got out of hand.
Now, that script exists out there somewhere. I know that people have either – I know the New Voyages guys bought it from Norman Spinrad himself, and I would be interested – has anybody read the script out there? I might keep an eye out for it at a convention or something just to kind of see it in context. I don't know which form. There were many drafts, so I'd be interested to see which draft exists out there. But this is a story that I've heard a lot about. Like, even the title, it's like, He Walked Among Us. It sounds very pretentious, you know?
Mm-hmm.
When I hear that title, I think of The Creature Walks Among Us. You ever see that?
Yes.
Horror movie. It's the third creature from the Black Lagoon movie where he turns into they perform surgery. They turn him from a fish man into a land dweller, which is like very odd. But hey, at least they're doing something different. So anyway, that's my favorite Universal monster, by the way, the creature from the Black Lagoon.
Yeah. He's a good creature. And, you know, I guess if the mummy had taken off, we would have seen him again. So what are we going to do? All right. So the next one we have is called The Lost Star. It's a common name, right? Lost Star is a recent, what do they say? Young adult novel for Star Wars? Anyway, I did read that. Anyway, and with Lucas in the title. How about that? Written by John Meredith Lucas. So there's a couple of Star Wars innuendos here. This was Lucas's second show that he wrote after The Changeling. Again, one I thought was a brilliant episode.
Same.
And this was really cleverly done, right? So the Enterprise finds a solar system that is blocked, right? It's hidden by a force field, so no one can see it. And the Enterprise penetrates the force field. It gets severely damaged. I wonder what they would have done with the model effects for that. Maybe a show of the constellation. Anyway, Kirk leads a landing party to a planet to find, you know, materials needed to fix the ship. And they find these primitive humans living on the planet, but they're actually being kept as slaves. Called the old by a race called the Old Ones. So, and these Old Ones are living in a more modern city. So Spock finds the leader. Her name is Kolos or Kalos, Kollos.
That was the name of the Medusan, right? And
yeah,
isn't there truth, no beauty. Yeah. Right?
So she's training to become one of the leaders, and it's found that the Old Ones have perished long ago. So there are no Old Ones anymore. They just have a big city, and they have this lady. And this force field was created to just completely camouflage their solar system to prevent any of the surviving natives from coming back and doing any kind of outside intervention. So only a few leaders are selected and are aware of these huge technological advancements they have kind of behind the curtain. So after Spock mind melds, this is interesting too, with Kalos, and convinces her that the Enterprise is means no harm, and the Federation doesn't represent harm. The ship gets fixed, they're repaired, and the ship is set free because she creates a tunnel in space through the force field. And essentially, it sounds like, you know, they're not going to tell anything they've heard about it, right? That they, you know, they want to make sure that this society remains secret. But they do wonder if if Kalos now will change the world or be killed by those who fear it. So very, very interesting plot line. There's a lot of things from TNG that bounce into my head from this.
Yes.
But
yes.
It's, you know, I thought this was a pretty cool concept. However, you know, I guess the reason it didn't go anywhere was it didn't have a lot of excitement or you know, as they call the EI or the emotional involvement, that type of stuff. But hard to say. To me, just reading this outline, this concept, this could have been very fascinating, pretty well done. And because we now have seen incarnations of this plot line in bits and bobs from TNG, I'm not saying those were the best episodes necessarily, but they weren't bad at all. This could have flown, I think.
Yeah, first of all, your summary game is on point, Ken. But so well done. Of course, your two episodes you talked about were a little more straightforward than mine, so I'm just going to in defense of myself. But anyway.
It's not a competition.
But it is.
I see. Okay, game on. Going down.
You're right. There's a lot of TNG elements here. When the bow breaks, right, with the hidden planet. Mm-hmm. Also, clues where they pass through that the wormhole and the aliens wipe their mind, but they can't wipe Data's mind. That's actually one of my favorite episodes. So I think about talking about how they're going to keep this a secret and all that stuff to not, because they're kind of xenophobic, right? The aliens, they don't want anybody to know about them. Using Spock to communicate with his mind meld is cool. They totally could have done this. You know, some of these episodes we'll get to down the road, we'll be like, oh, okay, I can see why they scrapped this because A, B, or C, right? The main obstacle here was Stan Robertson, who was the guy from the NBC guy, basically, to put it in layman's terms, that kind of was the go-between for the studio and the show. He rejected the outline and said that though it was well written, it's lacking excitement, color, and emotional involvement. So it's interesting reading Cushman's books, you know, these are the voyages. Stan Robertson comes up a lot. And
right.
He sometimes, like any, you know, I think it's very easy to point like, oh man, the network, blah, blah, blah. Hey, sometimes the network actually has good ideas. You know, all art is collaborative, right? So sometimes they make some good notes, they make some changes. It turned out for the better. Sometimes not so much. And I feel like maybe they kind of overstepped their bounds here. I don't know. I haven't read the outline. I haven't seen it, right? But this sounds like a very interesting episode. And I would have liked to see it as part US. I think it would have fit in. I don't see anything that's like ridiculously out of place. I mean, we were kind of joking about He Walks Among Us. It sounds kind of absurd, and they couldn't crack it, you know. And Bandy would have been, you know, maybe tough to show like a emotive, expressive creature, you know, and with the budget back then, maybe it would have been better in animated form. Who knows? This one, I really see. I mean, other than like the city, but all you need is like a matte painting. Right, that's all you need, and then everything else is close-ups on, like, you know, on the planet set or something. Mm-hmm. So I see no real thing that's like, oh well, the red flag to like, oh well, that this wouldn't have worked or et cetera, et cetera. I think this would have been a really good episode of TOS from what I'm reading here.
Yeah, I think it would have been interesting to shoot. I also think that the way Star Trek is set up, you know, we like that pendulum swing from action-oriented to more cerebral to sometimes more sociological, whatever, you know, it's like flavor of the month with Star Trek. And everybody has, you know, their different appreciations for episodes. Right? You'll see if it touches on something that people get real excited if it's a social issue, or if it's an action-oriented, people get real excited because they like to see, you know, the Federation in action and come up with clever ways to deal with certain situations. And so, you know, when you read the feedback like that, there's a couple of things I think about. One, written in the 60s, here we go again. You know, it's the Cold War, it's Armageddon. You know, another society has wiped itself out because of, you know, a genocidal war, and you have the aftermath. Very, very common, very Planet of the Apes-like. You know, this is 1960s, you know, almost... you know, you could find the next movie or the next installment, if it's a sci-fi episode, of something that kind of impacts that. But what I like about it is, you know, it's thought-provoking, right? There's technology, you know, that camouflages the planet. There's the, I think it's very common, but I also think it's very important that the Federation once again can successfully convince people that we, you know, that the we, okay, that the Federation means no harm, right, and that it's a very positive and you know, our number one rule in law or whatever is non-interference. So, you know, when we interfere, it's normally by accident or something along those lines. So I do think that this show could have been written and could have been produced. It would have been interesting to see if it comes out as flat as, you know, they were predicting it to. I think that this one is another one that makes you think, and there's nothing wrong with that. And I think you have to have that good mix in Star Trek. And, you know, remember, Star Trek, the original series was, you know, wagon train to the stars. That's what it was sold as. A lot of the other things that came up later became the crux and the foundation for all the, you know, all the movies and Star Treks that followed. But while it was finding its way, these types of episodes would have helped define that culture, I think, even more solidly, because it's, you know, how do you reinforce something the way you reinforce something is by constantly going over it again and demonstrating consistency, you know, in the model that, you know, we're good, we're good, we're good. Here's another instance where, you know, we're trying to explore. We're trying to see what's out there. We didn't mean to break through your force field. We're in trouble. Help us, and we'll leave you alone, that type of thing. So it would have just been, for me, I know I'm talking a lot, this would have been an episode I would have liked to have seen done. Yeah, just because of Lucas's Changeling alone, I'd love to see what he came up with here.
Another thing that sticks out to me is you mentioned all, like, proving to another race or society that we're peaceful, we come in peace, right?
Yeah.
It's interesting in a lot of episodes of the original series, and like when you have an alien like read the computer banks, they're like, oh my god, you guys are terrible. You know, it's so if you look at the cold hard facts, right? Because who knows what other kind of societies, what other things other societies have gone through to get to where they are.
Right.
Right. Even like Deep Space Nine, Quark's like, when he's arguing with Sisko, I love, like, you know, the Ferengi. He's like, we never had stuff like slavery or this or that or this or that, you know? Mm-hmm. And so it kind of shows that, like, yeah, we, you know, we, even though, like, other races are all kind of in space with us, they didn't necessarily have to go through all the BS that we did to get to where we are. And if you just look at the cold hard facts, like, you know, sometimes they'll, you know, I think even like gosh, just like the Cage, right? Like Talosians, like they read all the computer banks and they're like, oh my gosh, you guys are terrible. Like, you're not suitable for our for our experiment anymore. So it's interesting when it's like, hey, look, yeah, all that stuff happened, but we grew past that, right? So we're fine now. So don't judge us by the stuff we did hundreds of years ago. So again, it's like just kind of proving yourself, and that's what Next Gen, right? It ends up being about, like, this, you know, never-ending trial to prove themselves to the Q, right? That we're, you know, worthy of being out there. So it's always like justifying your own existence and ability to transverse the galaxy seems to be a common theme in Star Trek as well through communication. But another thing I did want to point out about this one was the old ones come up, and that's something that's in all the Robert Block episodes. It's from Lovecraftian mythology. I don't know if this is a direct reference to those, but much like, you know, some of the old ones in some of the other episodes, they kill themselves off. They all died off and left all this great technology and cities and stuff behind. So I think that's interesting. There's still a little thread throughout Star Trek there of that. And you know, you mentioned stuff like Planet of the Apes. I guess I thought about this made me think a little bit about the time machine, at least the 1960 version of the time machine, where there's like this giant city, but there's, like, you know, there's the Morlocks and there's the Eloi, and the Eloi are like the slave race, and, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So, like you were saying, that was a pretty prevalent theme in sci-fi at the time, but lots of shades to that they could explore from the Star Trek lens. And I really like John Meredith Lucas. I really like The Changeling as well. It's one of my favorite episodes of the original series. So I definitely would like to see this one.
I think we're aligned, my friend. All right, order it up. Let's get J. Day and Tarantino to take a look at this.
that wouldn't be bad. Although the whole ship is damaged and they're stuck on a planet, they just did that and beyond.
Well, yeah, but it's not destroyed. And
what do we always say, Kim? We want to see the ship do stuff in these movies.
Yes. No, I'm with you. I'm just saying there's probably quite a bit of Tarantino dialogue in this one.
There you go.
Right? They can really start talking about things. So anyway, just conceptually, it would be interesting. I don't think it would make a very good movie, but it would have made a fun episode.
Well, maybe Discovery can take this and turn it into something down the road. So that's we got Star Trek going on right now. I wonder if they would ever look back at these super old scripts because, you know, they own them all. They're in the catalog there. But I don't know. I mean, how that's very unlikely.
it would be interesting, and there's probably people who will know sooner rather than later, but when season one wraps, you know, how conceptually did they come up with this? You know, why this timeline? Why all this stuff? Because it's really our timeline. 10 years is nothing, right? It's a blink of an eye in Star
Wink
Trek.
Of an eye.
So, yeah. So, you know, let's get on the phone with Chris. We should be doing these shows. It's they're in our era. Hello. You know, come on.
I love what Nick Anastasio has called it, pre-OS. That's what I'm going to continue to
pre-OS,
call it.
Pre-OS, yeah. It's pretty cool.
But hey, if Discovery lasts 10 seasons, then we definitely will be in our era, Ken. So
yes, there'll be a border war. Anyway. So
when we're doing this show 10 years from now.
Oh, can you imagine? Oh, yeah, yeah.
So today we're talking about the buttons on Kirk's chair. There are several buttons. Some episodes they you guys laugh. We're going to get there sooner than you think.
That's right. Which melted Skittle does this remind you of? Oh my goodness, yeah. It'd be fun.
Well, yeah, so this is it's always fun talking about these what-if concepts because we do what fanboys do and just extrapolate and imagine. And that's why we love this stuff because it fires up your imagination. Of course, I would have been interested in certain aspects of all three of these episodes, but definitely I think we both agree the Lost Star would have been the strongest one to build an actual episode from.
Yeah, what lends credibility to all of this is these were concepts that came up from the writers at the time. And, you know, it's not you and me saying, hey, what if we do this? What if we do that? Which I'm sure would be extraordinarily entertaining for our listeners. But, you know, when you're actually looking at things that you know, were written out by the writers at the time, you see the similarities and you see the struggle with creativity in time, right? I mean, you've got a whole universe. This is the first Star Trek show. And still, you know, they still constantly hit on certain tropes and certain things. It's very, very difficult. And it just shows you, I think, from the whole mosaic of all the different Star Treks or whatever, just how hard it is to continually come up with new ideas and new concepts, whether it's TNG, DS9, Voyager, Enterprise, and now Discovery. Give these guys a lot of credit. I mean, it really is not easy. It's easy to criticize, as we know that. You know, History of the World Part 1. Have you seen that movie?
Yes.
Yes, that very first scene, right? You know, art, and then was born the critic. So I do appreciate looking at these things through that that view of, okay, in 1965, 66, and 67, when they were focused on coming up with these concepts, you know, how original were they? How clever were they? And if you look at all of those episodes, all 79, you know, there is definitely some redundancy in there. But boy, what they did come up with was phenomenal, even if they didn't execute well.
Yeah, and this was a different time in writing. Right? They didn't have a quote-unquote writer's room.
Right.
Like they do now. Like, you know, these later shows, like they might have a couple of scripts. Maybe they like, we tried this one. It didn't really work out. But in, you know, TOS time, Roddenberry was like seeking out people submitting scripts, you know, sci-fi writers, whatnot. And that's why there's so many of these lost concepts. Good for us. Good for conversation. Right. That's why there's so many of these lost concepts. And yeah, I 100% agree. That's why it's so fascinating to me. It's like archaeological discoveries. Like, oh, these almost Star Trek episodes is exciting. And that's why I wanted to bring up, like, who wrote these? Like, you get David Gerrold, Gene Kuhn, Norman Spinrad, John Meredith Lucas. All these guys wrote A-plus episodes of the original series, and yet they're struggling to come up with a concept that the studio will buy and the show can translate and all this stuff. So it's not – the creative process is not an exact science. So there's a lot of trial and error, and there you have it.
There you have it.
Hopefully you guys enjoyed our – discussion on what if episodes, more lost episodes, basically. We're going to continue this lost episode subseries here. Ken and I have a lot of fun talking about these. Hopefully y'all do as well. As I mentioned, there are plenty more, so we're going to sprinkle these in throughout the year. And this isn't the only thing we've been talking about on Trek.fm, though, this week. Here's a quick look at what else you might have missed elsewhere on the network.
Previously on Trek.fm, Literary Treks.
But let's start with that first one, that Siege in Superspace. So, oh boy. Superspace, I don't know, is this better than subspace? Is it...
Well, I think it is. The thing I really love about this issue is we haven't had many stories at all about super space.
The Edge, a Star Trek Discovery podcast.
Right. So, okay, they're under orders. They're not supposed to talk about it, and that's how you maintain the continuity that Kirk and Spock are surprised that there's a mirror universe. I mean, that works. That makes sense. But these people were there. They know that there's doppelgangers there because they know that because Cadet Tilly became Captain Killy, right? They know this.
To the journey!
There was a lot of face melting in this episode. You're right.
Everyone's melting. What a world! What a world! It was, yeah, and everybody was slimy looking. Why were they so sweaty? Why?
Seven of Nine had this full-on Borg Queen look about her.
She did, and who else was really sweaty looking besides Seven?
Neelix was really sweaty looking.
Yeah, well, yeah, I thought he was.
And he had kind of a silver tone. He had the silver
he
blood.
He did. Like, he was distinguished. Distinguished melting Neelix. Yes.
Like, yeah, he got a buff and polish.
The 602 Club.
No, I mean, it was really all we had was like animated shows. Like you had like the animated Batman series, the animated Superman series, and as far as the big screen went, it was not so great. I mean, you had Blade. Blade was, some people cite Blade as kind of the precursor for the superhero genre picking back up, but it was very much kind of a genre film. I know technically it is a comic book film. I don't know if I'd count it in the realm of, like, big-budget superhero movies.
And that's what else is happening on Trek.fm.
So check out all these shows and join the conversation about your favorite corner of the Star Trek universe and beyond. You'll find us wherever you get your podcasts. If you're an Apple user, be sure to hit the subscribe button in Apple Podcasts on iPhone, iPad, or Apple TV, or the desktop iTunes app to get the latest episodes as soon as they are published. And please leave us a star rating and a written review. If you're not an Apple user, we've got you covered as well. You can find our shows on Google Play Music, Stitcher, TuneIn, Speaker, SoundCloud, Windows Phone, and most third-party apps, and you can stream and download the MP3 file from our website or grab the RSS link as well.
If you'd like to help us keep all our shows coming to you each week, you can become a patron of the network on Patreon. Visit Patreon, that's patreon.com/trekfm to get all the details. Perks include early access to episodes, exclusive content, producer credits, and more available through our special patrons website, Patron Zone. It requires a great deal of money to produce, host, and distribute these shows each month, so we really appreciate any support you can give us and hope you'll join the team. Again, you'll find all the details at patreon.com/trekfm. We also want to thank very, very much our esteemed associate producers, Norman C. Lau, Nicholas Anastasio, Tim Robertson, Richard Marquez, Corey Elrod, and Dan Rhodes. So Norm, Nick, Tim, Richard, Corey, and Dan, thank you from the bottom of our hearts. It means as much as we can possibly tell you the world to us that you've agreed to sign on and help keep Standard Orbit alive and well.
Yes, thank you so much, guys. We really do appreciate all your contributions. So we'd love to hear your thoughts on today's show, and there are many ways for you to do that. The best place to join in the larger conversation is the Babel Conference, our listeners group on Facebook. Just type B-A-B-E-L into the search field on Facebook, and it should come right up. If you'd like to send us email, you can use the form on our website at trek.fm/contact. Choose to send to a show and select Standard Orbit. That will come right to us. You can also find the network on Twitter at Trek.fm and on Facebook at facebook.com/trek.fm. As for us personally, you can find me on Twitter at MoronZach, that's MoreOnZach. And I'm also the host of my own show called Always Hold On to Smallville, where we talk about each and every episode of that young Superman show. You can find us on Twitter at AlwaysMallville with one S. What about you, Ken?
Well, you can find me on Twitter as well at Boston, SCPO, stands for at Boston Senior Chief Petty Officer. And I'm also on the Babel Conference whenever I can be, engaging and trying to add, you know, a lot of good provocative suggestions to our other shows. But anyway, we look forward to seeing you on the Babel Conference and responding back and forth on this show as well.
All right, well, that's going to do it for us this week. But stay tuned next time for another edition of Standard Orbit.